Good morning, everyone. Glad to see you here today. Hope everyone had a great week and you're doing good today. We welcome those of you who are with us in person. We'd also like to welcome those who are viewing online. And also, if we have any visitors, a warm welcome to you also. There are cards on the back of the pew. If you could please sign those and put them in the collection plate when it comes by. I don't know about you, but I really enjoyed that snow yesterday. It was so beautiful. I don't know if any of you had an opportunity to see how big those snowflakes were. It was just amazing. So I was kind of in awe that we live in Colorado and can have that kind of beauty. Let us open with a prayer. Heavenly Father, it is our privilege and joy to praise you. As we sing, let us make a joyful noise to you. As we pray, may our words and thoughts be a pleasing aroma to you. As we open your word, may we trust in your unfailing promises. Open the eyes of our hearts that we may see more clearly today. Through Jesus Christ we pray. Amen. Would you please stand for our first hymn?
Conquer evil and shatter the spear and sword. Well, good morning, everybody. How are we doing today? Wonderful and great. My goodness, this is a great day. I've had a terrible day so far, but I'm planning on it turning around here in the next hour, so I'm hoping so. Yep, especially if I can hit that D. I think I'll be in great shape. How about that? So we'll see. This is the time of service where we lift up our prayer requests and praises. So I invite you, whatever's upon your heart during this time, give it to God. And then after you've given that to God, know that it's time to worship God and just be prepared to meet God where he is. And it's here, by the way. It's here. And he's also out there, in case you're wondering. I was crossing the bridge this morning, and I watched two cars slide into each other. And God was there, and he was telling them both to slow down, and neither one listened. So, you know, when God speaks, you probably should listen. And so I hope that he shares something good with you this morning. I know he loves you. And so listen, he's talking. So let's pray. Lord, we come to you today and we do thank you for the gift of this beautiful morning. As Marilyn already mentioned, the beautiful snow yesterday. We thank you for the sun that is shining today. Lord, you give us so much good in our lives. Help us to remember today to be thankful people and thank you for those great gifts that you give. Of course, we remember today we are here to worship because of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. The sacrifices that he made, the gifts that he gave, and the lessons that he left. He reminds us to be the people of God, and he showed us how to be the people of God. So today, Lord, as we go from this place, remind us that we are the hands and we are the feet, that we show the love of God to people who desperately need to hear it, see it, and feel it. Help us to be that. We thank you, Lord, for your goodness and your kindness, and we pray you continue to guide us throughout this day. And now, as the children of God, we want to pray the prayer that Jesus Christ himself taught us as we say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Amen. We're having our time of offering, and so as the deacons get up and get ready to receive the offering, I'm reminded Ron was walking around with a great big orange bucket, Charlie. Did you see that? Full of pennies, and that's a great offering to God, is it not? Yeah, praise the Lord, praise the Lord. And so if it's a great big bucket of pennies, Charlie will count it while smiling. And you know, if it's a great big check, Charlie will count it while smiling as well. So there you are. So give what you're able to the Lord and be a blessing. Music. come to the table today and we are here to gather in the presence of God and remember what Jesus Christ has done for us and the teachings that he left for us. Today, this table is an open invitation to each and every one of you who are here today. We don't bar anybody from the table. You talk to Jesus Christ and he'll probably welcome you in, would be my guess. But make sure that you've given to God those things that might be called hang-ups or sins or whatever. Give that to God. Come to the table with a clean heart and then experience the gift of Jesus Christ. Because it was on the night of Jesus' betrayal. I say that and I hope you hear that. It was on the night of Jesus' betrayal. He knew that everybody he was offering this to was about to betray him, run away, abandon him. And yet, he broke the bread anyway. And he said, "Take, eat, this is my body, broken for you." Following the theme, after the meal was over, Jesus took a cup. He said, "This covenant, this new covenant, this brand new thing, my blood will cover you. Take, drink." And so we come to the table, we eat of the bread, we drink of the cup, and we proclaim the saving grace of our Lord and Savior until he comes again. We are not perfect people, but thanks be to God, Jesus Christ made the perfect sacrifice. And this is a gift from God to the people of God. And the people say, amen. Let us stand and sing. Be seated. Sam, you didn't see my high sign. I was waving at you. But Sam and the kids can come on down. Oh. You got to work your way around us, Sam. She has her binky. What do you guys call this? Do you call it a binky or a pacifier or
Dutch.
What?
It's called Dutch.
Nudge?
Dutch, yeah.
Wow, never heard that. Okay. Got a new one today. That's a grandma saying?
Yeah.
Well, then it is what it is. Hey, I have a question for you all. This is the pastor being kind of ornery. I apologize. How do you guys like being short? Huh? Did you know there's a guy? Yeah, I know. Oh, let's move along. Did you know there's a guy in the Bible by the name of Zacchaeus, and his whole claim to fame is he was short. He was so short that when he wanted to see Jesus, he ran over and climbed up in a sycamore tree to see him because Jesus was coming that way. And when Jesus saw him, he looked up and he said, "Hey, Zacchaeus," he said, "I'm coming to your house today. Come on down."
What?
And so he got to go dine with Jesus. Isn't that cool? So see, there's some benefits to being short, right? No, there aren't any. Did you know in my house, this is a brilliant thing on my part, we get Cheetos, right? And in a big bag. And did you know that if I take those Cheetos and put them above the refrigerator in that top cabinet way up and back there, nobody can reach them but me?
I can reach them.
You cannot.
Yes, I can.
So, well, you climb, and that's cheating.
No.
And so I try to keep them out of everybody's reach. But, hey, I was going to sing the song with you all. Do you know Zacchaeus' song?
No.
Look, Who knows Zacchaeus' song? You got to help me. Zacchaeus was a wee little man, and a wee little man was he. He climbed up in a sycamore tree for the Lord he wanted to see. And as the Savior passed that way, he looked up in the tree. And he said, "Hey, Zacchaeus, come on down, because I'm going to your house today. Because I'm going to your house today." You know that song?
Little.
Really? You never heard that song before in your life? You know, sometimes when I do Jesus passing that way, I do Little Bunny Foo Foo. Oh. And it's really, people wonder what I'm doing. So did you want to sing it again, or is once enough? Once is enough? Okay. All right.
Again.
Well, I have something for you. And Miss Renee, I know, or who's doing children's? Miss Renee's doing children's. She probably has more for you. But I have something for you. What? You want this one?
Yeah.
Okay, here you go.
And
this, that's beautiful. And this took a lot of work to get to you, so I hope you appreciate it. I was trying to make my printer work this morning, and guess what? It didn't want to. And so, and it had nothing to do with height, because, you know, it was just a problem. So, but I have good news for you all. Are you ready for the good news as I send you out?
No, bad news.
No bad news today. The good news is that no matter what size or height we are, God loves us all the same. Isn't that good news?
Yeah.
So it doesn't matter if you're 2'3", 3'2", 6'8". 8'6" would be impressive, wouldn't it? 8'6"? That's what you're aiming for, 8'6"? Good luck. God loves you, okay? So remember that and go sing that Zacchaeus song, because that's a good song, all right? Let's pray. Dear Lord, we thank you for today, and we do pray that you be with us and help us. Remind us that no matter what size we are, your love for us is 100%, and we thank you for it. And it's in Jesus' name we pray, and everybody said?
Amen.
Amen. Very good. Hey, I forgot, there's kids in the nursery. Take those to the kids in the nursery.
Our scripture message today is taken from 1 Corinthians 9, verses 16 through 23. Yet when I preach the gospel, I cannot boast, for I am compelled to preach. Woe to me if I do not preach the gospel. If I preach voluntarily, I have a reward. If not voluntarily, I am simply discharging the trust committed to me. What then is my reward? Just this, that in preaching the gospel, I may offer it free of charge and so not make use of my rights in preaching it. Though I am free and belong to no man, I make myself a slave to everyone to win as many as possible. To the Jews, I became like a Jew to win the Jews. To those under the law, I became like one under the law, though I myself am not under the law, so as to win those under the law. To those not having the law, I became like one not having the law, though I am not free from God's law, but am under Christ's law, so as to win those not having the law. To the weak, I became weak to win the weak. I have become all things to all men, so that by all possible means I might save some. I do all this for the sake of the gospel, that I may share in its blessings. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Okay. Sorry I keep bouncing it, Stephen. I apologize. I may have to take my stole off. See, I don't wear a stole all the time, and today I've decided to wear it, and it's just going to go wherever it wants, so that's how it happens. In 1 Corinthians, the chapter 9, this ending is what I'm really focusing on, where Paul talks about all these different things. To a Jew, he becomes a Jew. To a Gentile, he becomes a Gentile. To a weakling, he becomes a weakling. To a strong person, he becomes a strong person. Those outside the law, he becomes one outside the law. You know, even though, hint, hint, I'm still under the law of Christ. It's an interesting statement. It kind of makes you think, what this feels flip-floppy. You know, what are you doing, Paul? Why are you doing this? It seems to me that often we more talk about Christ is our rock and Christ is our refuge, and we hang on to Christ and we stand strong in our convictions and we don't ever come off our convictions. And if somebody has a different conviction, well, too bad for them. We stand strong. And so what this is in chapter 9 seems to me to be hard to kind of figure out. So I always have to, when I get a scripture that's hard, I also always have to think about some kind of story that might help me better understand the scripture. So growing up on the farm left me with a lot of stories, obviously. You guys are probably tired of hearing farm stories, but it just left me with a lot of stories. And one was lunch. I love lunch. I don't know if you all know this or not. Lunch is the greatest meal in the history of the world. It just is. You're in the middle of the day and you've been working hard and the sun's up and it's getting hotter and hotter and it's beginning to beat down on you and you're really beginning to feel it, when all of a sudden from the house comes this siren call, lunch! And you just, oh, praise the Lord. Thank you, Lord, it's lunch. And you can go into somewhere where it's a little cooler and you can have a wonderful meal, and it's just a beautiful thing. And my dad liked to take a nap after lunch, so I got to read a book even. That's even better, isn't it? Isn't that the cool part? So to help me with this passage, I remember that story because working on the farm, we didn't stop. My dad didn't believe in let's stop. That wasn't in his vocabulary. Or, you know, we've had enough. Let's quit and wait for lunch. No, it was this project, and if you get done with this project, there's that project. And if you get done with that project, well, Lord help you, there's this project. And, you know, it just keeps going. It never stops until somebody calls lunch, my mom. And my mom never waited for us to get done because she knew my dad. There is no stopping and coming for lunch. Lunch would be ice cold by the time my dad, when the sun went down, would say, well, I guess we shouldn't work outside anymore. It would be ice cold. So mom has to call us. And so She calls out to us, and there we are, dirty, filthy, probably greasy messes. And you know what we are? Called. We're called. And so we get up and answer the call. Never in the history of my farm life did my dad ever say, "Let's skip lunch." Once he was called, we went. This is the heart of Paul and his ministry. This is what he truly believes. Call them where they are. Call them where they are. Dirty, messy, greasy, filthy, sinful messes, doesn't matter. Call them. Share the good news of Jesus Christ with them. Give them the gospel message in whatever way it takes that they can hear it. Whatever you have to say that they hear the gospel message, you do that. Then, Paul also believed, you let the gospel message do its work. You let the gospel message clean them up. You let Christ work. Now, as we enter the Lenten season, it's coming quick. It's going to be on us before we know it. There is no better time for us as Christians to stop and reflect. What do our hands look like? How are we doing? Are we following Christ's call? Are there some dirty spots we need to clean up? Is there a mess we need to take care of? A time of reflection, a time of confession, a time of a call to clean up. Because I don't know if you know this or not. Paul, Christ, and my mom might have been calling us to the table, but there was an expectation. For my mom, it was pretty obvious what it might have been. When you got to that table, your hands sparkled. I mean fingernails, brush, clean it out. I mean good-looking hands. Forearms too, of course. You know, it could get deep, you know. And so my mom had an expectation. Clean hands. Clean hands. And I think Paul and Christ are saying the exact same thing. They'll call you where you are, and they extend a call to anyone. It doesn't matter how deep in the sin or muck or whatever you want to call it you're stuck. God's still calling you, but God has this incredible expectation. This next step is upon you. When you come to the table, you got clean hands. You just do. Jesus talked about this in Matthew 22. And in Matthew 22, the king was throwing a great big banquet. His son was getting married. It was a big deal. And so he reached out to other highfalutin folk in the area, and he said, "Hey, I'm having a wedding banquet. Come on." The call was extended. Come on. Well, the rich and the powerful were rich and powerful, and they were kind of busy. And one said, "I got to go do this." And another said, "I got to go do that." And yet another one said, "Well, I'm going out of town. We'll see y'all later. I can't be there." King was pretty frustrated about that. He called, and he had an empty table. Well, that would not do. That would not do. And so the king reached out, and he told his servants, he said, "Go tell everybody. I mean, everybody and anybody is invited to this. They can come to the king's banquet. They can sit at the king's table. They can have the king's food. This can be an awesome day for them. All you got to do is come. Come on." And so the parable goes on, and people are there, and the party is started, and the room is full because people accepted the invitation, and they were excited to be there, and here they are, except here's this one dude. He came to the banquet, and he didn't dress up at all. He didn't stop and reflect at all that maybe the king might want him to wear his Sunday best. He didn't reflect and think that maybe the king didn't want dirty hands at the table, dirty minds at the table, dirty hearts at the table. Maybe the king wanted him to clean up first before he came. Well, Jesus doesn't pull any punches. Jesus says that the king said, my friend, he called him a friend, my friend, what are you wearing? And then he called to his guards and he said, bind this guy. Tie him up. Throw him out. No one with dirty hands. No one with an unclean mind, no one with a half a heart is going to sit and worship at my table. No. Now that's the parable from Jesus. I tend to trust Jesus when he talks about this stuff. And so I believe that we are all called. But we're not called to come in the situation the call was extended. Yeah, I was stuck in the mud, deep in the mud, when Jesus Christ called to me. I had sin. I was living a life that wasn't pleasing to God. I mean, I'm not lying. And yet he called to me and he said, Scott, come to the table. And I thought so much of that invitation, let me tell you, I cleaned up. I cleaned up my thoughts. I cleaned up my actions. I cleaned up my relationships with other people. I've tried to do my very best in that regard, knowing I can't do 100%. 98, I can't even do that. But I can do my very best, which means I'm cleaning up. So that when I come to God's table, when I come to God's banquet, when I finally get to get called up yonder, I can walk in there at least having given the effort to have cleaned up. Now, the call is always good. And I will never judge another person on their call. I'm just not going to. But I can challenge you. Because what I believe is that Jesus taught us how to clean up. I really do. I believe he taught us. Love God is a big one. I agree with love God. But there's more. We need to learn to treat others as they would like to be treated. Did you hear how I tweaked that a little bit? We need to learn how to treat others as they would like to be treated. Just because I like to be yelled at doesn't mean Teresa does. So I don't yell at her. It's strange, huh? I might grumble and then run. But I don't yell because she doesn't like it. Learn to treat others as they would like to be treated. That's part of a cleanup. That's part of a cleanup. Think about others first. Put the needs of others in your mind. I'm not saying you have to meet them all the time, but at least be aware there are people in desperate straits. You might be called to help them. So do. Just do. And the biggest one, the hardest one. Forgive. Forgive. Because, you know, I was talking about that 100%. I may not accomplish 100% with Teresa. There may be a day I yell. Usually it's if KU is playing. But sometimes I yell at her. That's bad. She shows grace and forgives me, and I try to forgive myself. And you all heard the story last week about how well I forgive myself. I'm still, you know, holding on to that sin about, and as an eighth grade boy, you know, not calling the little girl out that jumped off base. But I try to forgive myself. That's a hard one. But we need to follow those. I mean, I hope, I got to stand for this. I hope if any of you have an issue with me or see me in a sin, you call me out. Now, I don't know how to break this to you. I would much rather you all call me out and give me a chance to confess than I go to heaven and God goes, "Oh, friend, it's a little late, and you're not invited to the party, so get out." I'd much rather you make that call to me. I know, it's a challenge. It's a challenge, and who knows how people will accept it. Sometimes they accept it great, and sometimes they don't want to listen. Well, you did your best. Good job. You did your best, and now it's up to them. But it's an open invitation with me. I'd much rather you call me out than God Almighty. And so today we come and we remember the farm story of being called. I don't know what shape you were in when you were called, but I had dirty hands. And there was an expectation with the call that I would truly understand the grace of that invitation. I didn't make one thing at that table, but I got to eat. We haven't done one thing that deserves our place at the table with God, but Christ has. Christ has made a place for you. Seems to me we should listen to what Jesus says and do our very best to follow it with all our heart. Not half, with all our mind. Don't get distracted. And yes, with clean hands. God bless y'all. Real good. And man, I hope when Christ returns, I'll be found with a clean heart. Today, again, we offer that invitation to you all. We're not here to judge. We're here to invite. And if you haven't accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, we invite you to come forward during this time and accept him. That's the first step of clean hands, is just simply accept Jesus Christ. You either believe what he said and you believe what he stands for, or you don't. And I think you all do here. And so I give you the other options. If you want to join the church today, we invite you to come down and join the church. We'll welcome you in. Or maybe you jumped in a puddle this week and you're a little dirty. Just give it to God right now. Confess it now. Don't wait. None of us are guaranteed a safe passage home. This is your chance. If you have done something that you feel is separating you from God, take care of it right now. You will find a God of grace, you will find a God of mercy, and you will find a God of forgiveness. Let's stand and sing.
Oh, my God, when I
don't. There is a team meeting Tuesday night.
Worship team, yep.
Okay, just a team meeting.
I'll agree with that. So we'll talk worship. Might as well.
Okay.
Anything else?
No. Anything?
Shrove Tuesday. Pancake Tuesday is coming soon. It's not this Tuesday. It's next Tuesday. So, you know, bring your appetite. And Denise has done a really wonderful job working up a program here. So come and just, it's just fun. I plan on being completely ornery during it. So it'll be a really fun time, okay? So as you go out, I have to tell you about sin and forgiveness and all this stuff. So forgive me if you got to sit down for just a second. It's not as long as last week, I promise. So this morning, I'm out there. I walk out to the car. I tell Teresa, I'll see you at church. I walk out to the truck. And, you know, I park my truck outside because Teresa has to take up the whole garage with her car so I don't door ding her. You know, she parks sideways in there. And so I'm outside. So I go outside and I go to open the door and it's frozen shut. And so I try all four doors. They're all frozen shut, every last one of them. So I say, I got this. And so I take the handle on the car and I go, whoop. And you know I'm standing on ice when I go whoop. And I go, whoop, whee. And so I figure, well, I might as well check the oil plug while I'm under here. It was a pretty good slide, I have to admit. I didn't know I would fit under my truck. And so I kind of whooped right under there. That was how my morning started. I tell you what, though, I'm feeling better already. Thank you all. You're all helping me, and I'm glad you can smile at my misfortune. So I pray you don't slip on any ice this week, but if you do, I pray you get up because God loves you, and he wants you to keep going. God bless you all. Real good, and amen.